Recorded Books and One Click Digital present April 1865, The Month That Saved America, by Jay Winik. Narrated by the author.
Introduction. Atlanta had been overwhelmed. Columbia had been surrendered and burned. Charleston had been abandoned. The peace conference at Hampton Roads had been fruitless. And the British and the French had refused to intervene. The Army of Northern Virginia, after striking its own harsh blows against the Union in the six bloodiest weeks of the war, from the Wilderness to Cold Harbor, had wriggled free of the enemy's clutches and fallen back, converging in a defensive position around Petersburg and Richmond. Across the slim divide of the battered landscape lay Grant's swelling Army of the Potomac. It was the Confederacy's direst crisis since the start of the war. Vaster than the fall of Vicksburg, more terrible than the failure at Gettysburg, and more traumatic than the toll of Sharpsburg. This time, the South stood irrevocably alone. But a smoky light filtered off the James River below Richmond, a strange emotion prevailed throughout much of the Confederacy. It was, Southerners knew, not the first time in history that defenders had been pitifully whittled down into pieces by attacking legions. Cut in half, starved, demoralized, enervated, and yet somehow had found the will to prevail. They still had four armies in the field, and man for man some of the finest fighting men in all of the history of warfare. Their guerrilla fighters and cavalry were second to none. Their lineage, they reminded themselves, was impeccable, stretching from the Jamestown colonists of 1607 to the founding fathers of 1776, and included George Washington himself. This kindled and rekindled their dwindling resolve. So did their prayers, and so did their own spirit, however waning. And so fervent were they in their desire to earn their independence that after an extensive, protracted debate, they had even held out the promise of freedom to any black man who would fight for their cause. Now, confronted by the dreaded prospect of losing all, they looked to their leadership for another George Washington, a figure who could rescue the South. In these desperate times, after all the suffering and death, after the multitude of exhaustion and despair, such a man or such men was the Confederacy's final chance. In the trenches of Petersburg, there was such a man, and across the Confederacy, there were such men. As a weary Abraham Lincoln, who had braced the Union when the blood was thick and victory seemed lost, so deeply feared, Robert E. Lee and the generals who looked to him for leadership, and a good many of the Confederate citizens who looked to him for guidance, were as aggressive as ever, not ready to give up, to give in, or to relinquish their Confederate identity burnished in the fires of war. This war was not over, not by a long shot, and the implications for the peace to follow were profound. It is the eve of April 1865. Even today, what followed in the remaining days of the Civil War seems almost miraculous. April 1865 is a month that could have unraveled the American nation. Instead, it saved it. It is a month as dramatic and as devastating as any ever faced in American history. And it proved to be perhaps the most moving and decisive month, not simply of the Civil War, but indeed quite likely in the life of the United States. Too often, it is at a small red brick house in Appomattox, Virginia, on April 9, 1865, Robert E. Lee's fateful meeting with U.S. Grant, that the story of the Civil War stops. Yet this is a mistake. For one thing, the war was still not over. It could have lasted several more hard months, even years. For another, no period was more harrowing or had so great an impact upon this country as the days that followed Lee's surrender. Within 6 days, Abraham Lincoln was dead, the first ever assassination of an American president. Never before or since in the life of this nation has the country been so tested as in this 1 week alone. Nor have so many tales of human drama and so many remarkable events, surrender and assassination but two among them, occurred with such breathtaking simultaneity and far-reaching consequences within a simple span of some 30 or so days. Indeed, the whole of April 1865 was marked by tumult and bloodshed, heroism and desperation, freedom and defeat, military prowess and diplomatic magnanimity, jubilation and sorrow, and finally, by individual and national agony and joy. Consider a few unforgettable images. This 1 month witnessed the poignant, frenzied fall of the rebel capital at Richmond and its government on the run. Lincoln's unprecedented walk through Richmond the next afternoon, as the city still smoldered and burned and its newly freed blacks brushed him with their hands. One of the most savage battles of the war, fought along Sailor's Creek, and the daring and daunting prospect of the South forming guerrilla groups to press the conflict and bleed the North with grave long-term consequences. It saw Lee's defiant efforts to head south and reunify with General Joe Johnston, while fervently proclaiming, "We must all determine to die at our posts." The Army of Northern Virginia forced marching in a labored, hurried retreat, an unduly complicated effort marked by heartbreaking mistakes, remarkable stoicism, and near split-second decisions with cataclysmic results. Lee's reluctant yet dignified surrender to Grant at Appomattox, accompanied by Grant's equally dignified and largely unprecedented handling of his fallen foe, a masterful act that set the tone for the rest of the war and the peace to come. It glimpsed Lincoln's eerie premonitions of death just days before his own assassination, followed by the successful plot to kill the president and a near-successful plot, foiled only at the last moment, to decapitate the entire Union government, threatening the revival of more ruinous war. And while sporadic fighting continued in the South, the Union was plunged into near chaos as the first-ever presidential transfer of power in a crisis commenced, amid widespread hysteria and rage, with the inauguration of Andrew Johnson of Tennessee, an illiterate until age 21, who had met with Lincoln only once since the inauguration. This 1 month also beheld an angry nationwide search for John Wilkes Booth, while intensive on-again, off-again negotiations were waged to produce General Johnson's eventual surrender to William Tecumseh Sherman, as other rebel generals and would-be guerrillas in the Deep South, in the backwoods, and in the far west watched, waited, and pondered their next steps. And of course, it ushered in the start of the nation's reunification. But even as the war climaxed to a close, there remained the most significant question of all, one that had consumed Abraham Lincoln, haunted him, kept him awake at night, and etched lines of worry deep in his face. Not simply how to subjugate the Confederacy by force of arms, but more importantly, how to reunite two separate political, social, and cultural entities that had been bitter military enemies just days before. "There is no greater task before us," Lincoln bluntly told his cabinet, or for that matter before any future cabinet. In truth, this was the foremost challenge of April 1865. This accomplishment, two nations becoming one, perhaps among the most momentous of all time, makes the story of April 1865 not just the tale of the war's denouement, but in countless ways, the story of the making of our nation. For historians, it is axiomatic that there are dates on which history turns, and that themselves become packed with meaning. For the English, it is 1066, the bittersweet year of the Norman conquest and the beginning of the most widely spoken language across the globe today. For the French, there is the powerful symbol of 1789, marking the dawn of liberty and equality, and just as accurately, the stunning transition between the old order and modern French society. For Americans, one magic number is, of course, 1492, the year marking the discovery of America, which is to say its Europeanization, or 1776, the American Declaration of Independence. But April 1865 is another such pivotal date. It was not inevitable that the American Civil War would end as it did, or for that matter, that it would end at all well. Indeed, what emerges from the panorama of April 1865 is that the whole of our national history could have been altered, but for a few decisions, a quirk of fate, a sudden shift in luck. Throughout this period, there were critical turning points, each of which could have shattered a fragile war-torn America, thrusting the new nation back into renewed war, or even worse, into a protracted, ugly, low-level North-South conflict, or toward a far harsher, more violent and volatile peace with unpredictable results. Time and again, things might have gone altogether differently. For instance, we are sorely mistaken if we believe that Lee had no options after the fall of Richmond, or if we assumed that his final retreat could have ended only in wholesale capitulation. Or, as opposed to what 200 years of smooth constitutional government may lead us to think, we would be equally mistaken if we believe that the constitutional provisions guiding the Union cabinet, as it prepared to hand power over to Andrew Johnson, were anything but awkward, uncertain, and exasperatingly unclear. In truth, one cannot understand how the nation came together without seeing the element of choice and uncertainty, or what historians often call contingency, that hung over every dramatic event in April, from the final military battles to the diplomatic meetings, from the weighty political decisions to the tense presidential succession, from the deep and drastic social dislocations in the South to the raw nerves and excitement in the North. History is not a random sequence of events, and never more so than here. In a sense, the story of April 1865 is not just one of decisions made, but also one of decisions rejected. Lee's decision concerning guerrilla warfare, with immense if not unforeseen ramifications, was one such decisive moment. Grant's choice to be magnanimous at Appomattox was another. And then, of course, there is the first ever assassination of a president, Abraham Lincoln, itself an unthinkable event. In light of the panic and chaos that followed, crucial questions remained. Would Southern leaders seek to take advantage of this moment of fleeting weakness, or find new spirit in the North's woes? And would Northerners now flirt with government by cabinet, as they had when John Tyler succeeded William Henry Harrison, or inch toward military or autocratic rule, as some, cabinet members included, feared? Or would they impose far harsher terms upon the South and the remaining Confederate soldiers? And finally, there are the subtle but powerful efforts not just of Lincoln, whose wisdom and foresight shine in these days as vividly as at any other time in his career, but also of high-ranking military men, North and South, to resist what one historian has labeled the hoarse cry of vengeance, and instead do their part in peace to help heal the country. Ever since the founding of the Republican experiment in 1776, the United States was still very much a fragile entity, and each generation was fearful of its prospects for survival. They knew that most republics throughout history had been overthrown by revolution, or had collapsed into dictatorship or civil war, or had succumbed to uncontrollable anarchy. That same fate, they feared, could be theirs. And their fears were hardly unfounded. History, then and now, is littered with bad endings. As Lincoln said, the Civil War was a time of great testing. In many ways, never were the temptations or threats for an imperfect peace, or a time of unbridled enmity, or a protracted, low-grade North-South conflict, or even the allure of dictatorship, greater than in the final month. Whatever may have followed, in these most crucial of days, none of this happened. How this came about is an important and neglected story of America. In the end, only after each such concatenation draws into focus does April 1865 come to be seen as not simply a crucial and coherent period of the Civil War in its own right, but as an essential cornerstone in the events that ultimately brought America together. To understand this is to grasp something precious. It is to see our country anew. Prelude, A Nation Delayed. Spring came slowly and laboriously to the mountaintop that year. The rain lingered, turning the paths and highways to mud. Then the cold returned, hardening and freezing both. The red buds threatened to blossom late, and so did the fruit trees and the dogwoods. The garden, too, was in need of tilling. The beds clamored to be cleaned and pruned. But most noticeable in the spring of 1865 was the silence. There was still the same awkward corkscrew road, the same 2.5-mile winding climb to reach the grand house perched solidly on the flat crest. But almost nothing else was the same. The clop of horses' hooves and the clatter of buggy wheels had all but died away with the home's first owner. Now, almost 40 years hence, things had fallen into near ruin. The front steps were broken. The roses had run over into the walk. In every direction, cracked windows looked out, not on its creator's dream of a bustling mecca of democracy, but on desolation. Inside, the once gleaming parquet floors were littered with grain, the once lively parlor now echoed with the bellow of cattle on one side and the squeal of pigs on the other. The once magnificent study was dust-filled, barren, and disconsolately quiet. Everywhere, the quiet. It was not supposed to be this way. This was not what the 26-year-old lawyer, planter, turned erstwhile tinkerer and philosopher had imagined when he had staked his home high atop an inhospitable wilderness rise. It was to be his hermitage, or retreat, and he intended to construct no less than his own little Zion. Only in the name do we find any requisite trace of humility. The young Thomas Jefferson decided to call it Monticello, meaning Little Mountain. In its very placement alone, Monticello was unique. By 1769, this swath of royal Britain was already blessed with growing cities, all pulsing with commerce and industry, and the sights and sounds of jostling humanity. Farmers in muddy boots making their way to the taverns, blacksmiths fresh from the forge plying their wares, merchants standing beside makeshift stalls, shouting to customers to step up and inspect their goods, pamphleteers hawking their ideas, and newly arrived settlers wrestling with the particulars of their common lives. And, too, it was these cities, Williamsburg and Richmond, and New York, Philadelphia, and Boston as well, that were the intellectual spokes of the New World, redolent with the steady cry of politics and the slow building of civic lives out of which an infant country would soon be formed. But not for Jefferson. "I view cities as pestilent to the morals, the health, and the liberation of man," he scoffed. To the Little Mountain, then, secluded and remote, he went. But above this barbarous bank, could it be done? Would it be done? Not easily. Problems plagued every phase of construction. For a 10-year span, Monticello's well had insufficient flow to meet household needs. For two of those years, it was completely dry. There were troubles with the brickmaking, with the finished woodwork, with the oversized windows and with the hardware. The chimneys were laid too low and billowed smoke back into the house. The fireplaces themselves gave out too little heat. Some rooms were so frigid, like his much-beloved tea and dining rooms, and even his study, that Jefferson lamented, "The ink freezes on my pen." There were endless delays because of the lack of skilled labor, or out-of-town labor, or the slave labor, or just plain incompetence. Despite many tries, his carpenter columnist, Richard Richardson, could not get the columns of the swagger portico straight. And there was the dome room, for its builders the most vexing part of the whole affair. Ironically, once it was completed, there was no way to heat it, nor was its staircase ever finished. The only access to the room was through a dark, cramped passageway. Stunning as it was, the room made no sense. It was never formally used. Still, Jefferson continued to alter, improve, and remodel Monticello for the balance of his life, a full half century. After spending 5 years in Paris as minister to France, the restless Virginian returned with a whole new conception in mind and abruptly tore down most of what he had already built. When he became president, key rooms had not even been plastered. The exterior was ravaged by neglect. The entrance was a cavern of raw brick. And the house that he had been putting up and tearing down for more than 30 years was no more livable than it had been at the beginning of the American Revolution. As one guest wryly remarked, "It is falling around their ears." Was it worth it? Was Monticello the work of a beautiful dreamer, a visionary, a romantic, or an act of absurd, self-defeating conceit? Here, the house spoke for itself. When all was said and done, when the large tree trunks substituting for classical columns on the western portico were removed, and when the last bit of exterior work was finally finished 3 years before Jefferson's death, Monticello stood there, a rare gem, a house unlike any other home in the country, a curious blend of elegant architecture and everyday practicality, yet it was already one of the great homes of the United States, if not the world. In size, opulence, and personality, the building was enormously deceptive, the modest exterior scarcely suggesting its luminous interior, or its many rooms, 33 in all, or its vast size, over 1,100 square feet, or the myriad of interests housed within, from the cannonball clock in the entrance hall to the alcove beds. And most importantly, there was the political talk. Inside, these walls percolated the ideas that had forged a country and would change the world, whether the subjects were natural history or geography, matters of state or the human condition, the nature of man or the nature of government. Jefferson was an engaging host, and his guests, men like Madison and Monroe, Webster and Van Buren, and the Marquis de Lafayette, reciprocated in kind. Their dinners reverberated, in Jefferson's phrase, like Greek colloquia, and all assembled hoped that here lay the seeds of a second Athens, or preferably a new Rome. But there was one hitch: Monticello, breathtakingly beautiful and blessedly impractical, embodied not just the ideas and aspirations of Jefferson, but his contradictions as well. And by the same account, just as Monticello embodied the varied strains of Jefferson, so did the adolescent republic he had so assiduously labored to found. His disparate threads were woven not just through its vibrancy and its growth, but also throughout its very deep and real divides. It fell to the lot of one Virginian to define America. The great 20th century scholar C. Van Woodward would note, and no less than Abraham Lincoln had already agreed, saying, "Jefferson was, is, and will continue to be the most distinguished politician in our history." Yet, in more than one way, as the national fuse smoldered in the years running up to the Civil War, and in the anxious days leading up to the pivotal month of April 1865, that politician and that definition would be precisely the issue. Few men, even among the founding fathers, had brought such a rare combination of formidable energy and prodigious intellect to American life as Thomas Jefferson. Born into the Virginia aristocracy, he came from the same background as George Washington, was related to such great Virginia gentry families as the Randolphs and the Marshalls, and, with his melancholy but cool green eyes, his folded arms and intense gaze, had an imposing appearance which, as Abigail Adams once noted, imbued him with a look not unlike God. But it is his contributions to the nation that are most often recognized as monumental. During the seething decade between the Stamp Act agitation and the Boston Tea Party, many able pens and probing minds had set out constitutional solutions for British America's dilemma. Yet it was Jefferson, in 1774, who cut to the heart of the entire debate confronting the colonies in one brilliant treatise, Summary View of the Rights of British America, a distillation that crystallized and combined the primacy of individual liberty with the notion of popular sovereignty. His finest hour came 2 years later, in 1776, after the first shots of civil war with the British kingdom had been fired. The Continental Congress appointed a distinguished committee of five to consider a draft declaration of independence, in case the Congress agreed thereto. Jefferson was named to the committee, only 33, and despite the fact that the other members included the redoubtable Benjamin Franklin, and such eminent figures as John Adams, Roger Sherman, and Robert Livingston, Jefferson was made the chairman. He quickly rose to the task with his electrifying draft, produced in a handful of weeks, which was then adopted almost in its entirety. Its riveting sentence, with one crucial edit by Franklin, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness," said it all. And the Declaration did more than rouse a fledgling rebellion, or serve as a kind of national birth certificate. More than any other single document, it rapidly became the classic statement of America's purpose and enduring idea, and it would, of course, be drawn upon again in another turbulent time when Abraham Lincoln weighed the winds of approaching war, and again when he delivered the Gettysburg Address. Yet for all his intellect, his ebullient, inventive, and surprising mind, Jefferson, who was elected to Virginia's House of Burgesses at the age of 23, who would go on to become Governor of Virginia, America's Minister to France, its first Secretary of State, its second Vice President, and then twice its President, was a bedeviling grab bag of paradoxes that would cast an ambiguous shadow over his successors in the country for generations to come. He was a Democrat who boasted that he would always have a jealous care of the right of election by the people, yet he disparaged the swinish multitude and vigorously opposed direct election of the Senate on the grounds that a choice made by the people themselves is not generally distinguished for its wisdom. He protested that he had no wish to form a political party. If I could not go to heaven but with a party, I would not go there at all. But in the 1790s, he did just that. For years, he jousted peevishly with Alexander Hamilton over economic policies, yet he shrank from personal political controversy whenever it touched him. He lived in a deeply religious land, yet he detested clergymen all his adult life. He drafted the Declaration of Independence, yet not once did he himself give an exciting speech. A passionate idealist, he was a fervent hater, hating the speculators, hating the Federalists, hating the merchants, hating industrialists without distinction. Still, he meant to practice what he preached. He derided royalty, variously disparaging Louis XVI as a fool, the King of Denmark as really crazy, the King of Prussia as a mere hog in body as well as in mind. And upon his election to the presidency, he scrapped the trappings of aristocracy, of which George Washington had been so fond. Gone were the powdered wigs, the white coach, the dress swords, and the guards for the president's house. But if his plebeian principles were strong, his aristocratic appetites were infinitely stronger. In addition to the French wines he personally imported, the Muscat de Riverside, there were the blooded horses and costly mahogany forte piano, solid wood, not veneered, the coats and shirts from Savile Row, and the porcelain from Wedgwood and Dalton, the pâtés, the fine port and the thick hams, and the costly leather-bound books, some 15,000 volumes, to form a library without peer. And there was the debt. To subsidize his expensive tastes and lavish lifestyle, Jefferson borrowed money all his life, sold his own cherished library, and, astonishingly enough, died over $100,000 in the red. He even sought to sell his beloved Monticello to relieve his heirs of financial burdens, but remarkably, there were no bidders. And for all his cosmopolitan ideas, after the presidency, and this stunning fact provides profound insights into the Southerners who would one day seek their independence, he never once left his home state of Virginia, not even to go to Washington or New York or Philadelphia, and, outside of his hideaway at Poplar Forest, never ventured much beyond the amiable confines of Monticello itself. But among those conflicts that defined Jefferson the man was one that would ultimately cleave the nation that he had helped to construct. There was no greater champion of personal liberty than Jefferson, yet few men have reaped more from human bondage. The dark shadows of slavery penetrated every nook of Jefferson's long, illustrious life. Though he owned from 100 to 200 slaves, comprising some three generations of human souls and bought, sold, and bred slaves his entire life, Jefferson despised slavery, cursed it, under his breath, that is, and in vain tried to curb it, both publicly and in his own personal sphere. Yet at every step, his distaste was marked by temporizing, indifference, hesitation. In his notes on the state of Virginia, he bitterly denounced slavery in the harshest terms, arguing that it was not just an economic evil, which crippled industry, but a moral one that debased the slave owner even more than the slave, the most unremitting despotism on the one part and degrading submissions on the other. Indeed, he wanted no less than outright abolition, and few Northern abolitionists would ever argue more forcefully or more thoroughly against the peculiar institution. But almost as soon as they were completed, Jefferson sought to avoid a wide circulation of his notes because he didn't want fellow Virginians to read his scathing observations. Only 200 copies were printed, and he refused to have his name embossed on the title page. He told John Adams that he hesitated to publish the volume altogether. And though an emancipationist in theory, warning that slavery was the dreadful fire bell in the night, Jefferson never systematically pursued an end to its practice, not as governor of Virginia, or as reviser of its law code, not as secretary of state, not as vice president, not as a two-term president. Earlier in his career in Virginia, he boldly drafted a law for gradual emancipation, but then he never presumed to introduce it. Later, he included a blistering attack upon the slave trade in the Declaration of Independence, but it was struck out. He did not quarrel. Even in his twilight years as an elder statesman of America, when slavery underwent a terrifying acceleration in the South, he accepted the Southern contention that emancipated slaves could not live as freemen in the Southern states, but with a twist. They should be expatriated to form a separate and independent country in Africa, or the West Indies, or beyond the Mississippi, to which we should extend our alliance and protection. At Monticello, the story was no less complex. Upon Jefferson's return from Paris after a five-year absence, his slaves eagerly collected around his carriage at the base of the mountain, shouting and cheering, kissing his hands and feet, some crying and others laughing. There is every reason to believe that this affection was genuine. 2 years later, Jefferson would mortgage all of them, men, women, and children, to pay for the ambitious French-inspired renovation of his home. When strapped for funds, he even paid his hired workers and slaves, as he did with his carpenter, Reuben Perry. The daily routine of Monticello was equally sobering. In running his plantation, Jefferson's overseer severely flogged slaves, and more than once Jefferson was seen angrily shaking the whip. At least once, he may have done the flogging himself. And while he publicly denounced miscegenation, it is now widely accepted that he had had a black mistress at home and fathered at least one of her children. Perhaps most troubling of all, while many of Jefferson's own neighbors invoked his ringing phrases to justify the liberation of their own chattel, the glorious and memorable revolution, Jefferson never emancipated his own slaves, not in his lifetime, as did his young neighbor, Edward Coles, the future governor of Illinois, nor in his will, as George Washington did. Yet if slavery was a thunderclap reverberating across Thomas Jefferson's world, his paradoxical views on the Union were just as earth-shaking. For all of Jefferson's love of the United States, there was no fiercer patriot and ardent expansionist. His love of his home state ran even deeper. He referred to Virginia not just as a nation, but also as my country. He described Virginians as my countrymen, and for a time spoke of the United States Congress as a foreign legislature. He even called the Union a confederacy. And it was this duality, above all else, that fiercely tugged at him all his life, and in turn at the nation in the years before the Civil War. All throughout the late 1700s, and as president, Jefferson relentlessly pushed to expand America. In an age of imperialism, he was perhaps the greatest empire builder of them all. In Stephen Ambrose's richly descriptive words, his mind encompassed the entire continent. From the start of the Revolution, he conceived of the United States as one vast body stretching from sea to sea. In 1787, he was a principal author of the Northwest Ordinance, which helped bind the distant Trans-Appalachian region to the United States. Then, in 1803, he finalized the Louisiana Purchase. At the time, the United States was a minor country on Europe's periphery, with a population about equal to Ireland's. Now, this single gesture, which doubled the size of America, created the Deep South and opened up an ever-expanding frontier, would lay the foundation for Jefferson's Empire of Liberty. Here, civilization would brilliantly sweep across, from east to west, like a cloud of light. But what kind of civilization? What kind of America? When Jefferson took the oath of office as the third president of the United States, the fledgling republic was already a land of limitless opportunities and vexing contradictions. An expanding country, it was not yet a single nation. The first free and democratic society in the world since ancient Greece, it stood out as a utopia for the common man. Yet the individual states were a cauldron of smoldering resentments and seething differences, and human slavery was not just tolerated, but sanctioned. It had already changed its form of government just 12 years earlier, and was still in a fluid political situation. And as Jefferson and Americans looked westward, past the Mississippi to the Rocky Mountains, even to the Pacific, the perennial question remained whether one nation could, or even should, govern the entire continent. On this issue, Jefferson was torn. Until his dying days, he regularly propounded local self-government above all else, supporting states' rights against the Union, county rights against the states, township rights against the county, and private rights against all. He pushed for the 10th Amendment to the Constitution, limiting federal power in favor of the states. In 1800, he soberly warned that a single consolidated government would become the most corrupt government on earth. At the end of his first term as president, when New England was darkly threatening scission over his economic and political stances, Jefferson mourned it as an incalculable evil, yet he answered tepidly, "Whether we remain in our Confederacy or break into Atlantic and Mississippi confederacies, I do not believe very important to the happiness of either part." And he added this, "Separate them if it be better." True to his divided nature and divided philosophy, he was himself of two minds. Jefferson died in his bed at Monticello on July 4, 1826, at the age of 83. On that very same day, the country, marked by astonishing growth and breathtaking vibrancy, was celebrating the 50th anniversary of his declaration. There was much to celebrate, but discord was also part of the new American landscape. America's writhing over slavery, over sectional conflict, over states' rights, and above all, over its very national identity, bequeathed in no small measure by Jefferson's own ambivalent views. And with the benefit of grim hindsight, we know that these contradictions were only one of the more conspicuous links in a very long chain of American history. It is more than symbolic that by 1860, Monticello lay abandoned and largely in ruins, and that by April 1865, it had two owners, one a New Yorker, the other a Virginian, and was cared for by neither. More than 3.5 centuries earlier, in April 1507, Martin Waldseemüller, professor of cosmography at the University of Sandia, produced the first map showing the Western Hemisphere, a novo mundo with a long, snaking coastline. He called it America, after the discoverer of the new continent, an appellation that belonged as much to Amerigo Vespucci, the Florentine merchant, as it did to Columbus. Like an enormous board game whose pieces were slowly being put into place, the science of geography would eventually give way to the science of government. And by the time the founders gathered at Philadelphia in 1787, nationhood was beckoning. No words can capture the boldness of all this. America not just as a place on a Spanish map or one more distant outpost of the sprawling British Empire, but an actual self-governing country. A country not to be forged by 1,000 years of shared history and shared dreams, but to be conceived in the minds of a handful of men over a handful of months. With pluck, daring, iron will, and imagination, and a brilliance unsurpassed in history, the founders would in turn beget the national idea, a country unlike any since the beginning of time. But in the crucible of the occasion, fateful questions would linger. What would knit this country together? Was it to be one country and one nation, or perhaps two, or even several? And was it to last in perpetuity, or to be a brave and daring experiment in democracy that could yet founder? The fragility of America as a nation from its very first days cannot be exaggerated. Unlike the old world, America was not born out of ancient custom or claim. Its people bound together from the shadows of feudal bands, emerging as a nation by the time they could primitively write their own history. Where in most countries a sense of nationhood spontaneously arose over tens of centuries, the product of generations of common kinship, common language, common myths, and a shared history, and the collective ties of tradition, America was born as an artificial series of states, woven together by negotiated compacts and agreements, charters and covenants. It did not arise naturally, as in Europe or China or Persia, but was made, almost abstractly, out of ink and paper, crafted by lawyers and statesmen. Insofar as the early Americans had a nationality, they were for more than a century and a half British. In fact, it remains a curious twist of fate that America was at first Britain's idea. It was the British who finally persuaded the American settlers to accept some kind of distinct national identity. Significantly, even in 1776, their contract to become Americans, the Declaration of Independence, did not make them a nation. Indeed, the very word nation was explicitly dropped from it, and all references were instead to the separate states. Thus, the very heading of the final version of the Declaration of Independence described the document as the unanimous declaration of the 13 United States of America, and the momentous resolution introduced in the Continental Congress on June 7, 1776, by Richard Henry Lee and seconded by John Adams, declared that these United Colonies are, and of right ought to be, free and independent states. As historian Daniel Boorstin has noted, independence has not created one nation, but 13. There is more than a measure of truth to this. Like the colonies that preceded them, these new states were as dramatically different from one another as they were from England. Each jealously guarded its self-rule, its independence, and its sovereignty. Each meticulously gathered its own army, chartered its own navy, commanded military actions to protect its own interests, and oversaw its own Indian affairs and postal routes. Each had its own legislatures, its own functioning courts, its own taxes, and in time, its own individual constitutions. And too often forgotten is this simple but telling fact. Before independence, Americans were both British subjects as well as citizens of Virginia or Massachusetts, New York or Connecticut, or some other home colony. After independence, they were no longer Britons, but neither were they Americans. There was, as yet, no American country to which to attach their loyalties. And so they remained faithful, proud members of their sovereign state, Massachusetts or Virginia or Connecticut. To the extent there was an American national identity, it was unexpected, impromptu, an artificial creation of the Revolution, and secondary. And for all its genius, the U.S. Constitution provided no resolution. Until this point, constitutions were not national codes but national inheritances. They were not written down, but existed almost intuitively, the ethereal sum of a whole country's charters, statutes, declarations, informal understandings, habits, traditions, and attitudes. Yet for the United States, what had started out as an exercise to do little more than revise the existing Articles of Confederation, a loose system designed for the exigencies of the Revolutionary War, instead produced a far more audacious gamble, an entirely new body of laws, the Constitution. Nowhere on the planet had anything like it been devised. There it was, at once a central government with the authority to tax and to maintain an army, and at the same time, a republican government with its powers scrupulously divided among a president, a House of Representatives, a Senate, and a Supreme Court. But when it came to articulating America as one nation, the men at Philadelphia flinched. This was the one nut they couldn't crack. The word nation, or national, appears nowhere in the Constitution. Unable to reconcile the gnawing tensions between the proponents of the states, the anti-federalists, and the proponents of the new federal authority that would come into being, the Federalists, the founders resorted to the more ambiguous phrase, the United States. Even the very use of the word federal, or F-O-E-D-E-R-A-L, as it was more often written, was actually meant to describe a relationship resting in good faith, fides in Latin being the cognate of fides, faith. When it was all done, an elated George Washington recognized not just the historic import, but also the precariousness of the whole enterprise. it was, he maintained, little short of a miracle that delegates from so many different states should have united to form a national government. A national government, yes, but did it form a nation? That still fell a little short of anyone's miracle. Consider Washington's parting speech. He used the word nation in his farewell address, but only prescriptively. The name of American, which belongs to you in your national capacity, must always exalt the just pride of patriotism more than any appellation derived from local discriminations. This, of course, begged the question, was America a nation, or was it simply a community of states? What is clear is that in the architecture of nationhood, the United States had achieved something quite remarkable. As historian John Murren has succinctly put it, Americans erected their constitutional roof before they put up national walls. The result, with characteristic anachronism, and with the benefit of this ingenious contrivance, Americans had a country even before they had their nation. And in turn, the Constitution did something quite unique in the annals of human history. It substituted as precisely that, a kind of national identity. Americans are intellectually autochthonous, Gary Wills has stated, having no pedigree except that of the idea. But in the ensuing years, America would not be able to escape the price for such genius, the price of hate and blood in the making of nations. That would be paid in the Civil War. The seeds of discord were there long before the guns of Fort Sumter began firing. In the absence of common national identity, they were always there. The generation that wrote the Constitution was obsessed by the specter that Republican government would not survive across a vast domain. Tradition was against them. They were boldly obliged to repudiate a political axiom that had behind it the domineering authority of the renowned French philosopher Montesquieu, always the great Montesquieu. In the mid-18th century, he had pronounced that a republic could function only in a small territory. And the 13 original states together, even some of the larger states individually, were already considered too large. Geography, too, was against them. As Americans traveled farther south and trekked farther west, the wilderness and the rivers and the mountains rapidly created breathtaking differences. Differences in lifestyles, differences in culture, differences in economics, differences in political outlook. What did not change was the flip side of America's auspicious birth, the secessionist tradition, a tradition that was older than America, older than the Revolution itself, as old as the earliest colonial settlements. From the very start, the discovery of the New World had made secessions and withdrawals, separations and dissolutions, practicable across a full hemisphere, and from its initial beginnings, American life comprised not just relentless growth, but countless efforts to secede. The Pilgrims, of course, were the first self-proclaimed American secessionists, coming to Plymouth only after their failed effort to extrude themselves from England and the Netherlands. This was just the beginning. The colonies themselves expanded and in turn acquired their varied characters by secession. Roger Williams and Anne Hutchinson, separatist fanatics, were driven from their own Massachusetts Bay and founded Rhode Island. Thomas Hooker seceded to his Connecticut. Lord Baltimore enabled a group of Catholics to secede from English life into a community that, for a while at least, remained exclusively their own. William Penn provided Quakers with a refuge, and the American Revolution was itself a monumental act of secession. And on it went. Nor did this pattern change after independence. Indeed, for some 200 years, the powerful secessionist ethos was characteristically American. By the 1780s, many, if not most, Americans solemnly believed the nation would inevitably divide into two countries. And by 1794, they seemed to be right. As if to prove Montesquieu's dire predictions right, America suddenly appeared on the brink of splitting apart. The first spark assaulting national unity pitted not North against South over slavery, but West against East over taxes. Frontier farmers all across the land revolted against Alexander Hamilton's dreaded whiskey levy. They lived in towns literally hewn from the wilderness and in constant jeopardy, if not from wild animals, then from Indians. But one thing they wouldn't countenance was taxation without representation. They did far more than refuse to pay the infernal whiskey tax. They blithely shot at revenue officers who would collect it. They tarred and feathered federal officials who sought to change their minds, and they set fire to the homes of George Washington's hated representatives. Thus began the Whiskey Rebellion. In the weeks and months that followed, the rebels raised liberty poles bearing inflammatory slogans, passed out petitions of angry resistance, and formed urgent committees of correspondence modeled on their revolutionary predecessors. Then, after a serious military encounter in July 1794 between frontiersmen and federal representatives, war fever swept the country. By August, the call went out, and a clutch of whiskey rebels began to gather. Soon they were 7,000 strong, dressed for war, hoisting a six-striped flag, whooping and howling, and openly flirting with independence. The indelible rationale of their rebellion was the very same rationale of the Revolution. Like the ocean that divided England from America and mandated that there should be two countries, the mountains that carved east from west cried out, not for one, but two nations. It didn't happen. To the banging of drums and tramping of the march, President Washington personally reviewed an army of volunteer troops hastily assembled to quell the rebellion. In late October, the expedition, led by no less than a famous soldier politician, Light Horse Harry Lee of Virginia, converged on Pittsburgh. The imposing show of force worked. The leaders of the rebellion fled down the Ohio River, headed for Spanish Louisiana. But if the threat of secession had receded, it did anything but disappear. Remarkably, the next alarm came not from settlers, but from two of the very founding fathers themselves, Jefferson and Madison. Their Virginia and Kentucky resolutions of 1798 to 1799, authored secretly only a decade after the adoption of the Constitution, held that states in the Federal Union could nullify acts of Congress. By arguing that nullification was a rightful remedy in state and federal disputes, the two men thereby laid the political and conceptual foundations for national dissolution as well. The resolutions were never tested, but they were a dangerous weapon indeed. If invoked, both could have been fatal to the 10-year-old Constitution and even to the very existence of the United States, for, if only implicitly, they had unmistakably affirmed a basis for secession, another remedy that Jefferson had also privately contemplated. And it would not be long before the next blush of crisis, 13 years to be exact. The ensuing controversy occurred during the War of 1812 against Great Britain, with the advocates of disunion coming from the North in Federalist New England, disgusted with the iniquity of Mr. Madison's war, fed up with the folly of Thomas Jefferson's Louisiana Purchase as endangering the world's last hope of a republic, fearing their own voice to be under permanent eclipse. New England exclusivists let out a resounding cry for unified protest. To the horror and disgust of Southerners, the Senate debates of the time vividly attest to this. New Englanders talked not just of a separate peace with Great Britain, but more ominously, of outright disunion itself. From the very start of the war, Massachusetts, Connecticut, and New Hampshire had flatly refused to send their militias to fight. And New England even went as far as to collude with the enemy by investing money in London securities and selling supplies to the British forces. As Thomas Pickering of Massachusetts summed up the bitter feelings of defiant New Englanders, there was no magic in the sound of union. If the great objects of union are utterly abandoned, let the union be severed. By early 1814, that seemed to be a real possibility and a real danger. Massachusetts, with its socially conscious aristocrats and high-shouldered mansions, its fashionable upper-class enclaves and grassy residential squares, was on the verge of rebellion, and some, like the cleric Elijah Parrish, were now urging New England to cut the connection with the southern states. At this point, the call went out from Massachusetts for a winter convention in Hartford, Connecticut. Ultimately, cooler heads prevailed that December, and the Hartford Convention did not urge secession as feared. It did, however, endorse the next strongest thing, nullification. Nullification and secession would eventually lead first to approbation, then to separation, and ultimately to the nightmare of civil war itself. By the end of the 1820s and into the early 1830s, after the government had been in operation for more than 40 years, the language of nullification and state sovereignty and the notions of self-governance and regionalism had become indelibly embedded in the American vocabulary. Thus, much like Jefferson, when many Americans spoke of the Union, however much they had come to love it, they spoke of our Confederacy, or more simply of the Republic. The Constitution, however revered, was a compact. The United States was just as often the States United, with a small s, or the United States, with a small u, or even a League of Sovereign States, and was invariably spoken of as a plural noun. The term sovereign was associated far more with the individual states themselves than it was with the general government, and state legislatures took for granted their right to instruct their United States senators on how to vote on important legislation. As a consequence, the road to civil war was paved with civic bricks like nullification and secession. Nor did the studied ambiguities of the Constitution do much to solve the cycle of secessionist threat and counter-threat. To be sure, the crucial question was raised. Did the Constitution create a union from which no state, once having joined, could escape except by extra-constitutional acts of revolution? Or did it create a union of sovereign states, each of which retained the right to secede at its own discretion? In the face of these incipient signs of sectional tension, Americans increasingly wrestled with this issue, but they quickly realized there was no clause in the Constitution that established the Union's perpetuity. Where the Articles of Confederation contended that the Union shall be perpetual, the Constitution only spoke of a more perfect Union. Actually, Charles Pinckney's draft resolution containing the provision, "The Union shall be perpetual," was never even brought before the general body for consideration. Where the Constitution was framed in the name of "We the People," Article 7 firmly declared that it would be ratified between the states. In the end, to the extent that there was a discussion about the perpetuity of the Union, there was no consensus. No less staunch a Federalist than James Madison wrote, "Each state is considered as a sovereign body, independent of all others, and only to be bound by its own voluntary act. In this relation, then, the new Constitution will be a federal and not a national constitution." What did Americans make of all this? In truth, in the early 19th century, the wording of the Constitution gave neither the believers in the right of secession nor the early advocates of a perpetual union a decisive case. Hoping for the best, the Founding Fathers instead left the question of perpetuity to posterity, and the most common perception of the Union was that of Washington. America was worth a fair and full experiment. And where for many the Union was much beloved, for many others it was an experiment valued less for its own sake than as a means to certain desirable ends, namely the protection of the people's liberties and the defense of the country from enemies abroad. And there the tension lay. Between 1830 and 1833, the pendulum of secession swung again, indelibly and seemingly permanently, this time to the South, to South Carolina, which demanded nullification and echoed the principles of regional self-interest and regional self-rights with its efforts to nullify the collection of federal tariff duties. This crisis was averted temporarily by Andrew Jackson's firm response and a compromise ingeniously proposed by Henry Clay. And, for a time, it appeared that Southerners and Northerners might still march together toward forging one nation. But with each passing year, the prize that many of the founders had sought, union, again increasingly seemed elusive, as the strains of secession hardened into a fierce debate that would at first consume the country, then divide it, and eventually plunge it into all-out war over slavery. From 1820 onward, throughout the next 40 years, the country lurched from one tense confrontation to another. The compromises of 1820, 1833, and 1850, the prelude of the Kansas-Nebraska Act of 1854 and of the Wilmot debates, the firebell of Nat Turner's rebellion and the Dred Scott decision, the terror of Lawrence and Pottawatomie, the rhetoric of the Lincoln-Douglas debates in the publication of Uncle Tom's Cabin, and last but not least, the spark of Harper's Ferry. Each constituted a powerful symbol that would transform the country's landscape and exacerbate the unresolved contradictions from America's founding. Throughout this period, Congress would become in many ways little more than a union-saving body, that and nothing more. It would not be enough. By mid-century, nowhere were danger and expectation held in more delicate equilibrium than in America. The country had doubled its population every two decades, leaving it behind only Russia and France. It had extended its continental reach from coast to coast and boasted a burgeoning merchant fleet worthy of challenging the leading nations of the Old World for global supremacy. It was a magnet for the hopes of countless immigrants, the English, the Irish, the Germans, the Jews, the Catholics, the Chinese, and for the dreams of Americans migrating along the new roads and new railroads into the ever-expanding Western territories. With an almost religious zeal, Americans felt compelled to press on west, to settle and republicanize, to civilize and democratize, and of course, when the gold rush began, to make money, studding the landscape with balloon frame homes and hand-hewn log cabins. Americans were suddenly everywhere over the immensity of its spaces. Chicago and Rochester, Santa Fe and Missouri, Oregon and the Great Salt Lake, California and Texas. The country was developing an incipient national art, an inchoate national literature, a thriving, rancorous press, and even a new national idiom. Though it was still a rural land, most Americans, as historian James McPherson points out, had no experience with the federal government other than through the U.S. Post Office. Major cities were emerging in Boston, New York, Philadelphia, Baltimore, and of course, Richmond. With its textile mills, foundries, and factories, there was even a new economic class, again typically American, the middling class. After a brief 60-plus years of history then, Americans were filled with an astonishing sense of optimism and a glowing sense of destiny. Increasingly sophisticated and wealthy, America was envied and admired in much of the world. But between the idea of equality enshrined in the Declaration of Independence and the notion of popular sovereignty, between the demands of nationalism and the intimacies of community, between the bumptious sense of manifest destiny of a growing nation and the hard rock of slavery, and above all else, between the dramatic struggle to forge a national identity and the emergence of distinct separate nationalisms across the great American expanse, stood an old and enduring tension in American life that refused to go away. The convenient version of history forgets the unbroken link of secessionist threats emanating from the country's earliest days, just as it intimates that it was only Southerners who flirted with disunion in these perilous later years. Northerners did too. While there is a sense that Daniel Webster did indeed speak for all the North when he thundered, "Liberty and Union, now and forever, one and inseparable," this is not so. Senator Walter Lowry of Pennsylvania echoed the sentiments of many when he warned that if the choice was between the dissolution of the Union and extension of slavery, I, for one, will choose the former. Or consider the words of a young John Quincy Adams, "I love the Union as I love my wife, but if my wife should ask for and insist upon a separation, she would have it, though it broke my heart." And then later, "If the Union must be dissolved, slavery is precisely the question upon which it ought to break." For his part, the prominent intellectual and clergyman Theodore Parker, who had no qualms about separation of the Union, argued that division was far, far better than allowing the poison of slavery to spread to the North. In these final years, slavery was the primary wedge cracking the underpinnings of national union, but it was by no means the only wedge. Too often overlooked is that during the run-up to the Civil War, New Jersey, for its own parochial reasons, flirted with secession, as did California, which with Oregon considered creation of a separate Pacific nation. The Mormons in Utah fought a handful of bloody skirmishes with the federal government, and they too sought freedom. And just months before Fort Sumter, New York City, which on and off in its history alternately considered independence and even confederation with the South, again threatened secession. Even on the eve of the Civil War, some Americans, hearkening back to the earliest days of the Republic, back to the Whiskey Rebellion, back to the War of 1812, still were speculating about the country splitting into three or four confederacies, with an independent Pacific coast thrown in to boot. By the time the war came, a torturous circle was complete. The delicate balance of America's paradoxes could no longer prevail. Indeed, in retrospect, it is little wonder that the country didn't break up earlier. The unsettled and unanswered questions that had gnawed at the country from the very beginning now had to be resolved by force of arms. And as the Civil War entered April 1865, dire questions remained. Could at long last those national walls be erected to support the constitutional roof? And could a now bloody, exhausted, embittered America survive as one country? The dismal examples from the rest of the world were not encouraging. To the South, the Latin American wars for independence had produced not one, not two, but some 22 separate nations from a few viceroyalties. With bewildering rapidity, these republics came and went, trapped for decades in a vortex of conflict and military repression. Nor was this simply a Latin American trait. Across the Atlantic loomed the specter of the French Revolution, the terror, the contagion, occurring as it did in the most advanced country of the day. France had been the epicenter of the Enlightenment. Its science led the world. Its books were read everywhere. Madison had Jefferson. Then the minister to France sent him $220 worth of books on government and philosophy to read as the founders undertook to craft the Constitution. Its language was the tongue of aristocracies, and it was the most powerful country in all of Europe, if not the world. Yet revolution plunged France, and in time all of Europe, into an ongoing cycle of terror and violence, the remnants of which plagued the continent for decades like a recurring nightmare. No country was totally immune, from Denmark to Sicily, from Bohemia to Hungary. And the problems of France and Europe in many ways resembled those of the United States. The fundamental question of nations and nationalities, the task of bringing the people into some kind of rational relationship with their governments and some form of mutual and moral relationship with their sovereign states. The founders themselves were acutely aware of all this. Indeed, they were haunted by it. The horror of France was anticipated even in the very design of the capital city, Washington itself. Rejecting the plan to lay out the city in elegant rectangular blocks and eye-catching right angles as in Philadelphia, the designers ultimately employed the radial plan, filled with ronds-points, or circles. In their conception and execution, these circles were to provide stations for armed soldiers, allowing them to maintain full command of the streets in case of any popular civil uprising or prolonged mob violence. Unlike in France, there should be no barricades in Washington. But the Civil War threatened to take the United States down a very different sort of road. As the European and Latin American examples glumly proved, it was not solely a matter of whether the North or the South won the war. As critical was the delicate matter of how the war would end, and how the peace would be made. Would the country emerge united, one nation, Abraham Lincoln's fervent dream? Or would it remain fragmented, ever ready to disintegrate into petty, squabbling, minor or fragmented republics, or become chronically vulnerable to anarchy or low-level violence, as was the dismal fate of many of America's European friends and Central American neighbors, and more generally, of other republics throughout history, and even in our own most recent century? The Civil War, then, in its final months, was more than a struggle for the soul of America, or the survival of the Republican experiment. It was a larger fight once and for all to construct the nation. It was in April 1865 that the outlines of the answer to this question would finally appear with clarity. As spring crept north across Virginia in 1865, Monticello, like America itself, now seemed more a monument to folly than a measure of grand design, more a finite experiment than a creation that could endure. Like so much of the country, it sat, rather uneasily, in no man's land. It was a house with two competing owners, one northern, the estate of naval officer Uriah Levy, one Southern, the Confederate entrepreneur Benjamin Franklin. It was a home with two competing souls, John Winthrop's City Upon a Hill and Thomas Jefferson's Declaration of Independence. And it was an estate with two diametric visages, one the best of America, the shining ideal of equality, one the darkest, the specter of slavery. But in a curious, deeply symbolic way, and despite all the neglect, it stubbornly remained a provocative reminder of the spirit of the elusive nation, as a shrine, not entirely Southern or really Yankee, a place where visitors still came to pay tribute to Jefferson, and where people could recall the moral imperatives and sense of high purpose that had once seemed so clear and compelling to the founders. And come they did, even in the Civil War, even on the eve of April 1865. Indeed, as the crisis of the Civil War intensified, Monticello was frequently the tranquil eye in the hurricane. Confederate troops had overrun it in 1862, but they were content to leave it in the hands of the old caretaker, Joseph Wheeler. No significant battles took place near Jefferson's Mountain. When Confederate John Bell Hood's Texas Brigade did pass through, they stood reverently on the front porch, the sacred portals, and mused about the famous statesman and his glorious memories. Over the next 2 years, on sunny days under the velvety sky, a few picnics were held on Monticello's lawns. On one bright autumn day in the fall of 1863, some convalescing Confederate soldiers even held a day of gaiety, a mock tournament of knights, most riding with only one arm, reins held in the teeth, dashing valiantly at the rings with wooden sticks employed as lances. Periodically, Northerners came too. Mostly visitors, wherever they came from, ended up in the Great Dome Room. Almost unused in Jefferson's day, it now boasted more than 1,000 of their names written on its walls. And while they left their signatures, bold or hesitant, many took away something else. Year by year, they chipped and chiseled away at Jefferson's tombstone, a 5-foot memorial that, upon his wishes, simply enshrined him not as president, but as the author of the Declaration of Independence. In drawers and keepsake boxes and on parlor tables, they preserve these pieces, as if there was something worth saving of the man and the country he had helped to create. But as April 1865 approached, what would ultimately be saved, if anything, depended on a handful of men, one of whom was readying to take his place upon an inaugural podium in the Union Capitol of Washington, D.C., and another of whom was urgently riding into the Confederate capital of Richmond, Virginia. Part 1, March 1865. Chapter 1, The Dilemma. The bells rang that day in Washington. Wherever there were brick bell towers and whitewashed churches, wherever rows of bells hung in ascending niches, wherever the common people could crowd belfries to take turns pulling the ropes, the bells sang. Bells were part of the American tradition. Cast in iron, bronze, copper, and sometimes silver, they rang with 100 messages, summoning Americans to Sunday services, marking the harvest and holidays, signaling the prosperity of planting, tolling the sadness of death, chiming the happiness of marriage, clanging warnings of fire or flood, or booming out the celebration of victory. Today, they rang with a hint of promise. It was March 4th, 1865. Inauguration Day in the Union. Abraham Lincoln had been at the Capitol since mid-morning, foregoing a traditional celebratory carriage ride up Pennsylvania Avenue to sign a stack of bills passed in the waning hours of the lame duck Congress. He was determined to make his own mark on them before the vice presidential swearing-in, scheduled for noon. Cloistered in the Senate wing, tracing and retracing the letters of his name, Lincoln remained the very picture of exhaustion. His face was heavily lined, his cheeks were sunken, and he had lost 30 pounds in recent months. Though only 56, he could easily pass for a very old man. He was sick, dispirited, and even his hands were routinely cold and clammy. And today, the weather itself seemed to be colluding with his foul and melancholy mood. That morning, heavy clouds moved over Washington as they had the day before and the day before that, whipping the Capitol with blasts of rain and wind. Even when the rain let up, the ground didn't. The streets were a sea of mud at least 10 inches deep. Still, the people came. On the following Monday, the inauguration rush would include a grand ball for 4,000. They would waltz and polka to the beat of a military band, feast on an elegant medley of beef, veal, poultry, game, smoked meats, terrapin, oysters, and salads, finish with an astounding wartime array of ices, tarts, cakes, fruits, and nuts, and then retire for the evening with steaming coffee and good rich chocolate. But that was for official Washington, for Lincoln's loyalists and Republican Party functionaries. This Saturday was a day for all the Union, and like a great herd, the people were seemingly everywhere. Their wagons ground to a halt underneath thickets of trees in the distance, and the thud and swish of their feet could be heard along Pierre Lafont's wide radiating avenues. All along Pennsylvania Avenue they converged, where the crowd stood at least 6 and 8 deep on the crude sidewalks. Around 15th Street, past the Treasury, where the stars and stripes hung from second-story windows, past Kirkland House and 10th Street and the National Hotel, where a clutch of handkerchiefs fluttered and gawkers hung out their balconies, and up the steep slope to the Capitol, past the greening swatch of emerald lawns. At street intersections, military patrols formed a watchful guard. So did the Capitol Police. Reporters and photographers crowded the stoops, ready to record the event for posterity. Flags waved, people cheered, and the band played. But mostly, the vast throng jostled for position by the east facade of the Capitol, newly capped by its gleaming dome and the towering bronze statue of freedom, to be near, even to catch a glimpse of the president himself. Finally, the presidential party moved from the Senate chamber out onto the platform. A roar of applause arose from the crowd as Lincoln made his way to his seat. It dipped and then mounted again as the sergeant-at-arms beckoned, and Lincoln stood, towering over the other men, and made his way to the podium. As Lincoln rose and moved forward, a blazing sun broke through the gray haze and flooded the entire gathering with brilliant light. Above and below, the collective pulse quickened. "Did you notice that sunburst?" the president later said. "It made my heart jump." But whatever ominous portent that moment may have held, it was overshadowed by the more powerful drama of Lincoln's speech. Succinct, only 703 words, eloquent and memorable, it was reminiscent of the Gettysburg Address, and at this crucial stage of the war, every bit as important. Summoning his waning energies, Lincoln began to read. As he rode into Richmond, Virginia, on that very same March morning, Robert E. Lee was met with none of the same fanfare. Slipping north from the trench lines ringing Petersburg, he must have felt that on this particular day, Union troops would have been loath to undertake any action. But he had a far more specific reason for journeying to the Confederate capital. Today, he harbored a single daring plan to reignite the waning fortunes of the Confederacy, to somehow push the 11 states toward eventual independence. And he had come to confer with Confederate President Jefferson Davis, the insomniac head of the Southern government who liked to wage war from his dining room, with maps unfurled and instruments scattered across the table. Lee's ultimate calculation was as bold as it was simple. Abandon Richmond, and take his forces south to meet up with General Joe Johnston in North Carolina. Leave U.S. Grant snugly ensconced in a City Point camp, holding the bag minus the string. From there, they could continue the war indefinitely. In the early pre-dawn hours, Lee had already vetted his options with General John B. Gordon, a shrewd, able warrior and one of his most trusted lieutenants. That meeting had proved to be an eye-opener. A Confederate courier, sent by Lee, had roused Gordon sometime around midnight, and it took the 33-year-old 2 hours of hard riding and a bitter chill to reach the commanding general at his Edge Hill headquarters outside Petersburg. There, as Union troops slumbered and Washington celebrated, Gordon found Lee surrounded by a long table strewn with recent reports from every part of the army. One by one, Lee handed Gordon the papers to read. Lee, his face tight, already knew what was in them. Despite a score of earlier tactical successes, the news was dismal. For 9 months now, Lee's men had been living in a 37-mile labyrinth of trenches, stretching east of Richmond and southwest of Petersburg. Three times in July and September and again in October, Grant had hurled his troops at Lee's Army of Northern Virginia, only to have them repulsed. In one instance, the Battle of the Crater, it was an outright disaster for the Federals. What Grant had hoped in the early spring of 1864 would have become a quick war of maneuver, open battle, and offense had instead become a prolonged siege. One surreal month after another, the two exhausted armies shadowboxed from their trenches. Throughout the summer and fall, the earthworks reverberated with abrupt, all-out attempts to break Lee's lines, sudden, unexpected death, and round-the-clock sharpshooting. This pendulum of harassment was punctuated only by the tedium of the siege, which was hardly any more palatable. As winter set in, the coldest in memory, Lee feared that unless his thinly stretched lines could be reinforced, a great calamity will befall us. Actually, the first great calamity was the plight of the men themselves. Despite Lee's efforts to secure food and clothing for his army, little was available. Scurvy, dysentery, and night blindness invaded the Confederate trenches. Simple cuts and small wounds refused to heal. The men lived with rats and lice amid the stench of urine, feces, even decaying flesh, staring up at the sky by day and often venturing out only by night. Morale plummeted. Eventually, driven by extreme hunger, assaulted by the biting cold, torn by letters from wives that movingly spoke of starvation and loss at home, deserters mushroomed, reaching 100 a day during the severe freeze of February. His hands tied, at one point Lee exploded to his son Custis, "I have been up to see the Congress, and they don't seem to be able to do anything except to eat peanuts and chew tobacco while my army is starving." When the long, low fever of the Virginia winter finally abated, the situation for Lee's men was no less desperate. Day after day, silence was punctured by the sporadic signs of war, billowing clouds of dense, roiling smoke, stabbing spurts of gunfire, the steady roar of bursting shells, scattered debris that heaved and shifted with each hit, and disemboweled corpses flying upward and out of the trenches. This Lee could live with. But as he shuffled field report after report in his headquarters at Edge Hill in early March, what now struck Lee was the destitution of his beloved army. There were no shoes, no overcoats, no blankets, and little food. Men scrambled between the legs of horses for dung to sift for undigested corn. There was insanity, exhaustion, wounds gone gangrenous, and of course, there was Grant. At the most, Lee now had 57,000 men in his army. Fewer than 35,000 were present for duty. Grant had, he believed, 150,000. Once reinforced by Sherman from the south and Sheridan from the west, Lee feared the Union commander would have 280,000. His calculations were not far off the mark. The Union had near endless resources, although not always the will to use them. As the minutes had ticked by that evening at Edge Hill, and after Gordon had read the reports, Lee had asked him for his options. Gordon reluctantly concluded that there were three: make peace between the two sides on the best possible terms, retreat and join General Joe Johnston's forces in North Carolina, or stand and fight where they were. Of the three, retreat and peace were the most promising ones. Lee agreed. But as he set out for Richmond after that largely sleepless night, the peace option had already been foreclosed. Peace feelers had been tried twice that year, their first culminating in a full-fledged conference on U.S. Grant's steamer, the River Queen, anchored off Hampton Roads. There, Lincoln and his Secretary of State, William Seward, had met with the diminutive Confederate Vice President, Alexander Stevens, and two other Confederate representatives. Ironically, it was the Northerners who had offered the South drastic concessions on slavery and immediate emancipation, but to the Confederates, their remaining terms smacked of unconditional surrender. Stevens, who had served with Lincoln in Congress and appeared as small and misshapen as Lincoln did large and gangly, said, "Mr. President, if we understand you correctly, you think that we of the Confederacy have committed treason, that we are traitors to your government, that we have forfeited our rights and our proper subjects for the hangman." Lincoln in turn responded, "Yes, that is about the size of it." The second feeler had come from Confederate General James Longstreet and Union General Edward Ord. They had proposed a meeting of generals, led by Grant and Lee, to come together as former comrades and friends and talk a little. Lee had conferred with Davis and subsequently sent a note to Grant offering to meet. Grant had wired Lincoln regarding the plan on March 3rd, exactly 1 month to the day after the failed Hampton Roads Conference, and Lincoln had wasted no time in killing this new one. No meeting, he chided, unless it be for the capitulation of General Lee's army. So, on that March Saturday, as an exhausted and careworn Lincoln took to the podium in Washington and a baggy-eyed Lee trotted through the streets of Richmond, peace looked quite dead indeed. The Abraham Lincoln, who gazed out at the inaugural crowd stretching before him, was a distinctly complex and often deeply conflicted man. Complex because the man who had pledged the previous summer in Philadelphia that the war would not end until its worthy object was attained, and, under God, I hope it will never end until that time, had returned from Hampton Roads in February and suggested to his cabinet that the United States pay the insurgent southern states $400 million as compensation for their lost slaves if they surrendered by April 1. The Union cabinet was unanimous in its rejection. And conflicted because the man who had affixed his name to the unequivocal words of the Emancipation Proclamation had also offered the Southerners the carrot of compensated and even delayed emancipation at that meeting if they would only return to the Union. Now, on this newly minted afternoon, Lincoln seemed to need the power and the firmness of his chosen words as much as did the anxious audience standing before him, or as did the larger expectant Union nation. When he started to read from a single sheet of paper printed in two broad columns, the crowd pressed forward slightly to catch every word. When he spoke, they nodded in silent affirmation. When he addressed his larger themes, they listened with deference, even awe. When he truly touched them, they burst into applause and even tears. Notably lacking from his speech, however, was any stinging attribution of blame for the war. All dreaded it, his voice rang out, and all sought to avert it. But one of the parties to the conflict would make war rather than let the nation survive, and the other would accept war rather than let it perish. And the war came. Strangely lacking, too, from the speech, after his brief first paragraph, was a reference to anything that he had said and done during the previous 4 years. His goal today was not to take political credit or to assign blame, but to send a heartfelt message to the Union and the Confederacy alike. Neither side had expected the war to last as long or grow to such magnitude as it had, he had observed philosophically. Each looked for an easier triumph, and a result less fundamental and astounding. Both read the same Bible and pray to the same God, and each invokes his aid against the other. On the matter of slavery, he reproached but absolved the South of the ultimate blame. It may seem strange that any men should dare to ask God's assistance in wringing their bread from the sweat of other men's faces, but let us judge not that we be judged. What was the war's cause? Somehow, he suggested, it was slavery. And how long would the war last? The question that was foremost on everyone's mind. Here Lincoln wearily made no pledge. Fondly do we hope, fervently do we pray, that this mighty scourge of war might speedily pass away. At the same time, he left no doubt of his intention to fight on, if God wills that it continue, until slavery was crushed and the Union was permanently reunited. He saved his most soaring and trenchant words for the conclusion, the true heart and the indelible spirit of his speech. With malice toward none, with charity for all, with firmness in the right, as God gives us to see the right, let us strive to finish the work we are in, to bind up the nation's wounds, to care for him who shall have borne the battle, to do all which may achieve and cherish a just and lasting peace among ourselves and with all nations. Lincoln then turned to Chief Justice Salmon Chase, soberly took the oath of office, and ended with an emphatic, "So help me God." Bowing his head, he kissed an open Bible, and then as he bowed again to the cheering assembly, an artillery salvo exploded in the wind. The Confederate White House stood several blocks from the state capitol. It was not designed as a public building, but rather came into being as the private home of a wealthy Richmonder, who had installed it in the mid-19th century miracles of gas lamps and crude but serviceable plumbing. When the war came, he offered his house for the new Confederate president, replete with its flat front and rear-facing porch, designed to protect the family from the dust and mud and pungent smells of the street. But he was also something of a prudent patriot. In a revealing bit of symbolism, he sold his home to the established city of Richmond and not to the fledgling Confederate nation. Its current occupant, however, harbored no such qualms about the Confederate cause. Jefferson Davis had used the failure of the Hampton Roads Peace Conference to rejuvenate Southern pride and nationalistic ardor, and the people had rallied accordingly from Richmond and Mobile, from Lynchburg and Raleigh, and other cities across the Confederacy. One by one, once passionate critics had also risen up in support of Jeff Davis and the cause. So, while resources were running scarce, Will was, for the moment, growing stronger. New appointments, most notably Robert E. Lee's recent promotion to commander of all the armies, and administrative changes had also led Southerners to believe again that the war's tide might yet turn. And everyone knew that the Robert E. Lee who came to Richmond that March morning was not simply the man who commanded an army of men pinned down in their trenches, but was the Southern general who had driven McClellan off the peninsula, stopped Pope at Second Manassas, hoodwinked Burnside at Fredericksburg, destroyed Hooker at Chancellorsville, and thwarted Grant in a wilderness, all against overwhelming odds. And while Lee himself understood that the Confederate hegira was at a turning point, perhaps even nearing the end, the Southern general-in-chief still harbored hopes of staving off disaster. This was, of course, vintage Lee, ever bold and invariably aggressive. Now, meeting with Jefferson Davis as Lincoln spoke of malice toward none and charity for all, the two discussed the Confederacy's options. Peace between the two countries was dead. But another option loomed. Withdraw from Richmond, retreat south and join Joe Johnston's army and strike hard at Union General William Tecumseh Sherman. Lee would have to make the most out of this opportunity. But he also believed that he could rely on the unparalleled endurance of his men, their loyalty, their fight, their overwhelming will in the face of the worst privations. In fact, this was also the opportunity he had long been waiting for. For some time, the commanding general had wanted to be free of Richmond. In January, Lee had secretly told congressional questioners that the military evacuation of Richmond would actually make him stronger than before. Richmond's fall, he confided, from a moral and political viewpoint, might be a serious calamity, but once it happened, he could prolong the war for a good 2 more years on Virginia soil. In truth, since the war began, precisely because Lee had been saddled with vigorously defending the nation's capital, he had been forced to let the enemy make strategic plans for him, to dictate far too much of the course of battle, and to determine the pace and time of combat. But, he added, striking a more hopeful pose, when Richmond falls, I shall be able to make them for myself. To Lee, one of the most daring and offensive-minded of generals, a war of attrition had always favored the North. As a strategist, Lee chafed under the yoke of defensive tactics. We must strike them, he had lamented. We must never let them pass us again. We must strike them a blow. Yet Lee also knew the harsh reality of the arithmetic of war. He no longer had any men to spare. If it becomes a siege, he had gravely told his general Jubal Early, then it is just a matter of time. At last, the time had come for Lee to make his own plans. Davis listened and did not flinch. Why not withdraw at once? He countered. Lee explained that the army's horses were too weak to pull the guns and wagons through the thick March mud, but in 2 or 3 weeks, the roads would be passable. Then he could make his move. In the meantime, he would make the necessary arrangements. And here the matter lay, with Robert E. Lee at 58, an imposing figure with a strikingly dignified face and an honorable pedigree, who could endure disappointment and frustration with stoic reserve, but who would not accept defeat. And with Jefferson Davis, the austere, ascetic, grim-faced, and obdurate Confederate president, the once poignant nationalist and unremitting Unionist, who now lived for Southern independence, that and seemingly little more. They, every bit as much as Richmond, were the polar stars of the Confederacy, its very embodiment. And on this fateful day, their decision was made. With this new strategy in mind, they would continue to fight with everything they had. In Lee's words, they would fight to the last. Under the jubilant eyes of Frederick Douglass, who would be ushered into the White House later that evening at the request of Lincoln himself, becoming the first black man to be officially received in the nation's home, and under the watchful gaze of the dashing young actor John Wilkes Booth, who occupied a prime spot in the balcony above the president, Abraham Lincoln had formally begun his second term. Now he had both a war to win and a nation's wounds to bind. To some, like his congressional critics, these two elusive goals may have been flagrant contradictions. But to Lincoln, they were nothing less than the bedrock of his policies, the true and definable purpose of this war. There were, he knew, some propitious signs that the national bloodbath was moving toward its preordained conclusion. In February, Sherman's army had driven into South Carolina like a tribe of thundering Mongols. And South Carolina, the Queen State of Dixie, where the nightmare of secession and rebellion had begun, quickly fell. Civilians deserted their houses and fled their cities before Sherman's approaching hordes. Then Columbia, the state's capital, lay in flames, incinerated, a smoking ruin, the victim of Sherman's men and chaos. Meanwhile, in the breadbasket of the Confederacy, the Shenandoah, Union General Phil Sheridan had cut a channel of destruction, wide and long, straight to the Rapidan River. And Grant's mighty Army of the Potomac was hunkered down around Petersburg, ready to drive into the heart of the Confederacy, into Richmond, into Robert E. Lee's vaunted Army of Northern Virginia itself. But there were also reasons why Abraham Lincoln was the most tired man in the world. For nearly every Union success, he could still count a time when Lee had been within their grasp and yet eluded his generals. McDowell, McClellan, Meade, Pope, Burnside, Hooker, each foiled. And Grant, too, decried as a butcher, sending the boys in blue into rebel range like cattle to a slaughter, mauled in the wilderness and now pinned down in Petersburg. Certainly there were, as Lincoln was well aware, indications that the Southern will to fight was waning, that the Confederacy was slowly coming to pieces. But there were also indications that the war could drag on for at least 3 more months of murderous fighting, perhaps even for another entire year, and, he bristled, how much more could the country take? And then finally, for Lincoln there was the unthinkable. The specter of Lee and his men slipping into the western mountains to wage a prolonged campaign of harassment. As much as any other scenario, this was now his greatest fear. The glory of a restored Union, he believed, must be built on more than butchery, revenge, and retribution. So, in the spring of 1865, this then was his dilemma. The exigencies of the total war that he was waging against the requirements of reunification and the peace that he hoped to make. Never were two goals more incompatible. Lincoln was so exhausted after the inauguration ceremonies that he took to his bed for several days. By March 14th, he would feel so ill that he would conduct a cabinet meeting in his bedroom. In the weeks that followed, Lee refined his audacious plan. As soon as the opportunity presented itself, he would attack Grant's lines below the Appomattox River, seeking to disrupt and disorient the Union commander. In turn, that would free a portion of his troops to quickly join Johnston and later to strike at Sherman. If his offensive failed, he would then abandon Richmond and Petersburg altogether, joining Johnston with his entire army. After a lightning march, he would hope to smash Sherman and then do what he did best, contest Grant in a prolonged war of maneuver. As the first hint of spring crept into Virginia, Lee's strategy had crystallized. After months of stalemate and tense confrontation, he had settled upon this. Shock Grant with a sudden assault on Fort Stedman, a federal strong point just east of Petersburg. To be sure, given the tattered state of his troops, it was a daring act.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.